Good evening, and welcome to tonight's public hearing. This hearing will include Columbus City Council's Health and Human Services, Finance, and Workforce Development Committees. I'm Councilmember Priscilla Tyson, President Pro Tem for Columbus City Council and Chair of the Committees. Before we begin, please be aware that this hearing is being recorded for rebroadcast on CTV, Columbus Government Television Channel 3. The rebroadcast schedule is available at www.columbus.gov. Tonight's hearing is one in a series of biweekly committee hearings that I hold in order to review legislation and the committees that I chair. This includes Health and Human Services, Finance, and the Workforce Development Committees. The goal of this hearing is to promote transparency and provide an opportunity for city residents to learn and to speak on legislation that impacts their lives. There will be occasions when a committee is not covered because legislation is not always scheduled for each committee. The intent of each hearing is to review legislation that will be on City Council's agenda for the following 2 weeks. Tonight, we will hear information on legislation in the Health and Human Services and Finance Committees. Presenters this evening will include the City Treasurer's Office, Debbie Klee, Treasurer, from Columbus Public Health, Dr. Teresa Long, the Health Commissioner, and from the Department of Finance and Management, Joe Lombardi, the Finance Chair. I will begin with legislation in the Finance Committee by asking Treasurer Deborah Klee to present. Good evening.
Good evening, President Pro Tem Tyson. This evening, I have one ordinance to discuss. It is 0456-2017, and it is a modification and extension of the City Treasurer's banking contracts on behalf of the City. As you know, the City Treasurer's Office had bids that it put out in 2012 for banking services and awarded contracts in 2013. This is the fifth year of 10-year contracts for banking, and it includes it's a total of $2,811,000 with three different vendors, Chase, Huntington, and Fifth Third Banks. Primarily, the largest sum of the money is $2.544 million, which is for credit card processing services on behalf of 10 different city agencies. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you, Treasurer. And can you just share the amounts that will be going to each of the banks, please, and the services that they provide?
Sure, absolutely. Here we go. J.P. Morgan Chase will receive $155,000. We have a contract with Chase for the City Treasurer's operating and payroll accounts, as well as the Department of Public Utilities for e-lockbox and income tax divisions ACH account. Huntington Bank for credit card processing is $2,544,000. We also have an account with Huntington Bank for an operating account, which is an account that collects all the different sources of revenue from credit card as well as lockboxes. We have a utilities lockbox with the Huntington Bank for $95,000. And Fifth Third Bank has our custodial account, which is for investment safekeeping, of $8,000.
All right, thank you very much, Treasurer, and certainly we'll be happy to present this legislation to the council members and to our residents in the next few weeks. Thank you very much. I would now like to transition to the Health and Human Services Committee and ask Dr. Long to present her legislation.
Well, good evening, Council Chair Tyson and members and colleagues. And actually, you have some esteemed guests here tonight as well to make presentations, I know. So I will be relatively quickly. We actually do have 14 items, which is way more than we usually have. However, seven of them are all connected, so I think we can go fairly rapidly through these. So the first, and actually I know actually all of these are near and dear to your heart, Council Member Tyson. The first, though, does have to do with community gardening and the community garden project for 2017. It's ordinance number 40416-2017. And actually, what I will present to you is a slight amendment from what actually you may have in writing. So this is, of course, related to the cities and our public health interest in trying to encourage people to eat healthy and to be healthy. So these are funds that Columbus Public Health has $20,000 in our health operating fund, $2,250, that we want to blend with $10,000 coming from the council's neighborhood initiatives fund. So the total amount of this ordinance will then read $30,000 will actually be moved from the city to the Columbus Foundation, the Foundation for Active Living, where then we will manage, co-manage with many partners, the 2017 Community Gardening Project. Again, I know you're very excited excited about this. We are as well. We have actually funded, with your support, $131,000 of support, but 186 gardens have been supported over the years. And indeed, last year, 12 of these gardens harvested 10,000 pounds of produce, which of course helped feed people, and it of course engages our many residents. More than 700 volunteers were involved in those gardens.
Thank you, Dr. Long, and you're absolutely right. I'm excited about the gardening program and certainly have been involved in it since its inception. And yes, certainly 10,000 of my amendment dollars will be going to this project. And certainly it is, this is a important component to the food plan that we passed at the end of 2016. And so it meets the really the second goal that we have to make sure that individuals have access to local, healthy, affordable food, and community gardening is a part of that. So thank you. Can you just quickly share what these dollars are used for?
Sure. So actually the grants are usually very small, in the order of, well, it could be as small as $500 and maybe up to $2,000. And it really is to help the gardens, the community neighborhood rooted gardens, get supplies. So some are donated, thankfully. Scott's, as you know, has been a great supporter, along with, and we work with the, Good to Grow to Green, Bill Dawson at the conservatory. So it's really a true partnership all the way around. But these funds are actually used to help them both buy plants in some cases, to buy supplies, to be able to make their gardens grow, which again, the residents who run and volunteer at these gardens are so appreciative of, because these are dollars that allow them to make the garden grow.
Thank you, Dr. Long.
So the next item is Ordinance 0472. This has to do with immunizations, something, of course, I know you care and we all care about. This is actually going to allow us to continue our state that gives us these funds, and they have to do with our immunization action plan. The total amount of funding that's connected to this is $132,252. The key aspect to this ordinance is actually the state is changing their fiscal year, so it is an extension of the grant period by 3 months. So they're taking 2 years to go from a calendar year to the state fiscal year. So this, of course, will extend for the first 3 months of that, so it will just take us through March 31st of 2017, and then in 2018 they will move it the full way to being a July 1st fiscal year. So again, the $132,252 will help us. I must also share with you that our state, like many others, are moving to a deliverable-only payment basis. So these funds, in part, to the great extent, will actually be only reimbursed when we, as your public health agency, meet the deliverables that they are requesting to be met in this. This is increasingly true for our various grant projects, but again, I just wanted to point that out. Again, we are very committed to vaccinating persons, especially children and low-income children who may not have easy access to immunizations. So I would share with you, and you have much more, I'd be happy to go into it, but we actually did provide about 35,000 vaccines last year, 29,000 in our clinic and another 6,000 in community settings, both in schools and in community venues. So we're proud of that work. These funds are only in part support of that effort, but again, it's all about protecting the health and well-being of both our children and our many residents.
Thank you, Dr. Long. And since you mentioned that that the state now has different criteria for the use of these dollars, do you see any issues in us being able to spend this, the full amount of this grant that we've been awarded? And that's number one. And the answer is no, then that's great. If the answer is that you do, there could be some concern about use of those dollars, then how can we promote that we have these dollars of the vaccination, the immunizations available, so that we do get full usage of this grant?
So, Council Chair Tyson, President Pro Tem Tyson, you're asking a really important question. We've actually been looking at this. We would never turn back funds that we didn't fully both hope to spend and actually try and spend. I can tell you that there are some things that we believe the state could do that would enable both us, and actually this is true of all the grantees. I work regularly with my Metro Health Commissioner colleagues around the state, and all of us have some concerns. Some of these funds in particular allow us to go into providers' offices and see how they are doing as far as their immunization rates of their patient population, and it would help us. Many providers don't necessarily want us to come, or it's, I don't know if I would say inconvenient, but they are not necessarily totally accepting that this is a part of our role and the state is asking us to do this. So again, here's a good example. We would hope that the state would make it clear to some of our pediatric practices or family practice practices that this is of course an interest of the state and to enable us to be able to do that work. And so we're still negotiating with the state. So that's a good example. There is a payment, a deliverable about visiting, and we of course will visit them, but will they allow us to do the work about going through their patient records? We've had a very good success record in the past and track record, but it doesn't mean that we'll get to as many providers as we would hope to, because it's not always that easy.
Thank you very much. Just keep me posted. Thank you.
I will. All right. So the next is actually the one that's the kickoff to six other grants. So this is our now annual acceptance and appropriation of the Ryan White HIV Care Act, and we call it Part A. There are different parts of this project around the country, and we have been awarded $4,315,456 in grant funds to fund this HIV Care Part A grant for the year beginning March the 1st, going through February 29th of 2018. And again, this project overall is to improve access to medical care for persons living with HIV and AIDS in Central Ohio. It is broader than just Columbus and Franklin County. And our goal is always to both achieve the best health status that we can for those persons, and that includes viral suppression, trying to reduce the level of virus circulating in one's blood system to improve quality of life and to reduce risks of spreading infection. And the grant itself in its many components does provide medical care, both physical health care, behavioral health care. It also can support substance abuse services, it can support housing services, oral health care, so it's a broad continuum of services, including, and maybe most importantly, this case management and linkage to the care services. So with that, I just thought I would share briefly, we have served, and the information you have, and that's complete because it's not a true calendar year, I have the complete information for 2015. So that is what we have shared here, which is we serve 1,733 persons with the medical case management. 1,300 persons received outpatient or ambulatory medical care. 350 received mental health services, 637 received housing support services and case management, and on. So again, it's a subset, but I think the big number is that 1,733 persons living here in Columbus and Franklin County and in several other counties have received the medical case management and the linkage to care. And hopefully, again, it would be the same persons who have likely received some of the other supportive services. So this ordinance, again, would allow, if you and your council colleagues support it, would allow us to accept, and then we are going to turn around in the next six grants or next six ordinances and give a lot of that money away. Most of the money actually goes away. So again, this is ordinance 451, and of course the other ordinances will depend on the passage of 451.
Thank you, Dr. Long, and certainly these are, we are appreciative of these dollars from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, and certainly these were not dollars that we, as we've talked about in the past, dollars that we have gone and asked the federal government to provide for us, but based upon just the numbers of individuals in our community that have HIV and AIDS, that these are dollars that have come into our community kind of unsolicited just based upon the numbers. And so appreciative, I'm appreciative of the fact that we have the dollars to provide to individuals who may have HIV or AIDS, but certainly we are wanting these numbers to go down as opposed to going up. And you know, I'm always going to be asking this because I know that in terms of our minority health and the disparities that we still continue to have a high number of African-American young men contracting HIV and AIDS. And certainly that is something that I think with the work of the health department, I know there's going to be an event next week in regards to this issue, in regards to the work around My Brother's Keeper. I mean, any organization that's really dealing with African-American youth, young men, certainly need to, we need, and I know this is part of next week, but certainly be reaching out to them because of the high incidence of HIV and AIDS in our community. So looking forward to the event next week. And since I brought it up, do you want to mention the event next week at Columbus Public Health?
So next Thursday evening, and actually it feels like everything is connected to everything, doesn't it, these days? So next Thursday evening from 6 until 8 p.m., we'll be hosting a conversation with our African-American community around the issues of opiates and how that is impacting our African-American community. We have been talking with our residents and with some of our community leaders, and they have very much asked for this kind of conversation. So we will be bringing both some information, but really listening ears, some of our city partners, some of our community partners to both hear. Also, we've got some community providers who will be speaking about the resources that are available both in our African community, African American community, but much more broadly in our community to support our residents. And honestly, we are very interested in what else we learn and how else we can organize and support our African American community in this area.
So clearly it's opiates, but also you think about the opiates, yes, and HIV and AIDS.
Absolutely.
I mean, anytime you're bringing people together, this is a significant issue.
Correct.
In our community because it's
Correct.
Still growing. Thank
Correct.
You.
Absolutely. The only other thing I would say about this HIV Ryan White Care Act grant and the subcontracts is while it is a formula basis, as you commented upon, and sadly a few years ago we reached that threshold here in Columbus, we actually receive a disproportionate increased amount because we write a good project and we are a very good vendor, so to speak. So we appreciate both the good work of our staff and of course the partner agencies, because we might not receive the same amount of funds unless we were able to deliver in those kinds of ways for our residents. So again, it's both a formula that gets us to the threshold, but then we have to deliver on the kind of work that we commit to.
Thank
so
you.
With that, let me quickly go through the different contracts. The first one is with Ohio State University Hospital. It's Ordinance 0488-2017, and this is a contract with the University Hospital for $81,734 for laboratory services and laboratory testing. Ohio State is one of our vendors for medical care through their internal medicine program, and they are actually required to use the Ohio State laboratory services. So again, to make that possible and to again assure the best care for those persons who are receiving care through Ohio State, we would appreciate your support of that. We realize this is not competitively bid. It is a requirement of the Ohio State Internal Medicine Program to use the Ohio State Laboratory Services. So again, it's for $88,734.
Thank you.
So onward, and the next, of course, is a contract. In this case, it is, again, the Ryan White Care Act. It's Ordinance Number 489-2017. Again, the funds are coming from the same pot of funds, and this would allow us to then contract with the OSU Internal Medicine LLC, the Limited Liability Corporation, for $240,000 of HIV-related somatic or physical medical care. And this, again, this grant would run through March the 1st through February. Actually, it should believe, I believe leap year is next year, so it should say February 29th. I apologize. And then, of course, the purpose, again, is to provide medical care for those persons living with HIV and AIDS in Central Ohio.
Thank you.
Want me to keep going? I'd be happy to. The next, again, is Ordinance Number 490-2017, and this is with the AIDS Healthcare Foundation here in Columbus and Central Ohio. And I guess I have not made mention specifically of the counties that are being served in this project. Of course, the majority of persons are living in Columbus and Franklin County, but we can also serve and do serve residents of Licking, Delaware, Morrow, Union, Madison, Pickaway, and Fairfield counties. And this is to allow us, this specific ordinance would allow us to contract with the AIDS Healthcare Fund Foundation for $240,273. Again, this is for medical care and medical case management services for the same time period.
Thank you.
The next item is, again, the same sort of contract. This is a contract with Nationwide Children's Hospital, again, for Ryan White Care Act services. This is Ordinance 491, 2017. And this allows us to contract with Children's Hospital for $461,393 to provide HIV-related, again, the phrasing is somatic medical care. It is for medical care and medical case management. And I'd be happy to respond to any questions about this item. So the next contract is Ordinance 492. This is, again, the same Ryan White Care Act, and this is with Equitas Health, serving, again, the same communities, and this amount is for $1,311,159 to provide, again, HIV medical care, somatic medical care, and medical case management services for, again, the same time period of March the 1st through February the 29th of 2018.
And thank you. And Equitas is now moving to the Near East Side.
Equitas is going to have a new location. They are not moving. They are going to have two locations, is my understanding. You may know more, but I believe they are opening a new medical center. So they will still have a North High presence in the Short North, and they are also going to have a Near East presence, which is very exciting.
I think they're going to be on Long and Hamilton.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. On the Near East Side, which I think is great.
I think it's great, too. So the next item is with Southeast, Inc. for, again, Ryan White Care Act Services. This is Ordinance 493, 2017, and this allows us to enter into a contract with Southeast, I still call them Southeast Mental Health, but with Southeast Inc. for $510,933.80. And this, of course, is to provide services and to help us on the medical care side, and I believe some of the mental health services that are also connected to this work. And I'd be happy to respond to any questions regarding that. And that is the last one of this series.
I don't have any questions, but it's really important that individuals who certainly have HIV or AIDS certainly have getting the primary care,
yes,
medical care that they need, as well as some of the behavioral health services.
Absolutely.
So thank
you. So the next item is one that we have put before you and your colleagues many times. This is for TB test kits. So the name of this specific test is called the Quantiferon test or TB Gold test. It has actually got a sole source vendor named Keogen. And so this ordinance 5010501 for $29,734.40 would allow us to purchase these test kits to be able to provide what is the gold standard for TB testing. We are strongly encouraged, actually told by the Centers for Disease Control, to use this test. My colleagues have explained why we're waiving competitive bidding, both it is a sole source, but actually if we were to look at other testing protocols and other test ability, it would not be the gold standard, which again, we like knowing if someone is being diagnosed with TB or tuberculosis that they actually have it. And as you know, that we would also be very concerned, we actually have this all set up with our test technology, with our testing and our staff. It would mean if we were to step away from this process, both a poorer quality test, but also a big expense as far as setting up any new process. I thought I would also just share with you that while you have received information, we now have the complete count for the tuberculosis cases for 2016. So we had 50 cases of tuberculosis, active TB, here in Columbus and Franklin County. Interestingly enough, and it will relate to one of the other items, we have a huge volume of persons who are foreign-born who have tuberculosis. That doesn't mean they got it in a country of origin. 51% of those persons, so 80% of our TB cases were foreign-born persons, but 51% of these cases have all been living in the United States for more than 5 years. So again, it is newer residents, newer Americans, but it's not just persons who are being actively resettled here who are bringing tuberculosis with them. Again, we are seeing a lot of persons. We do a lot of TB tests. We had over 4,000 clinic visits last year. Many children are tested at the central reception area or central registration area of Columbus City Schools. And of course, we do a lot of outreach and education along with our clinical services. And again, the source of all of the funds for TB control are from, as you know, their county commissioners.
Thank you. And certainly, you've stated why we should, obviously we're waiving competitive bidding. We certainly want to make sure that we have the best test available for our residents.
And thanks. That's exactly right.
And that's with this particular vendor. Thank you.
That's correct. Thank you. So the next item is to appropriate funds for the CPAC, or the Chemical Emergency Preparedness Advisory Council, and for the program at Columbus Public Health that supports that. It's a part of both a federal requirement. Again, these funds really do come from the county commissioners, both via a federal grant. And again, the amount being talked about in Ordinance 531-2017 is $72,576.60 that do support our work and our staff member who leads the Chemical Emergency Preparedness Advisory Council. And again, this is about knowing where chemicals are stored in Columbus and Franklin County, and then being sure that all of those organizations that are storing or producing chemicals have emergency plans, that all that emergency contact information and their emergency plans are both stored with us and stored with our Columbus Fire and our other fire jurisdictions should there be an emergency. There are also requirements for drills that come as a part of this whole project. And I'd, of course, be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. It's important that we have someone on your team that is responsible for this effort, because we want to make sure the safety of our residents is our number one priority. And so by having that documentation of what kind of types of chemicals are in our community, we'll make sure that our safety forces are prepared if there ever were an incident. And again, the number one priority of this city is the safety of its residents. Thank you so much.
You bet. Thank you. The next is an important contract to us. It's a contract with Access to Interpreters. It's Ordinance Number 537-2017. And the purpose, of course, is to allow us to enter into contract with Access to Interpreters for $150,000. We do need interpretation. We try first, as you know, to employ people who are bilingual. We've done a good job with that, but it's not nearly enough. So these services would allow us to contract with Access to Interpreters. This is a bid contract. So this vendor is the lowest responsive, responsible, and best bidder. The contract period would run from April the 1st, 2017 through March the 31st, 2018. And then allow us options, again, if satisfactory service for years on the outside, but again, those would come back to council again. I thought you might be intrigued by the numbers of languages that we provided interpretation for last year. It really is A to Y. It starts with a language called Agri, and it ends with a language called Yoruba. And in fact, there are 48 languages that we provided interpretation for. So again, it's a very diverse group of people we are welcoming to our community and clearly to our services at Columbus Public Health. We did provide nearly 2,779 face-to-face interpretation services, and provided nearly 3,300 language line or phone line services. So again, we have been very busy serving our residents that may not have these kinds of services widely available in the community elsewhere.
And Dr. Long, can you share with the viewing and listening audience? So you just mentioned that you have a team that speaks many languages, but the ones who are unable to speak all the languages, how is your team able to provide these languages to them? How does it work?
So when we learn, and sometimes it's right when someone's coming for services, or ideally we know ahead of time, either they're being referred to us by a provider in the community, and they tell us ahead of time what language is needed. If it is Spanish or Somali, we're able to do that pretty much on our own with our staff, but not always, because we may have staff in different places, and they can't be in more than one place at a time. So in that case, we call access to interpreters, and we prefer all of the interpretation if we can have on site, but they too may not have all of those languages in their call it a stable in their group. So some of them have to be either online by telephone, or actually we have a computer system where we can actually have face-to-face, like a Skype-like translation. So again, some of the languages are more common, but some of them are very uncommon, and it would be the more uncommon languages that we would have to call up. And actually we can get translation in a very short order. So again, usually it's a matter of minutes, but we obviously prefer to have and know ahead of time if we can, so we're all set to go.
Thank you very much. And certainly, as you said, we are a smart and open and welcoming city, and clearly this legislation is another example of making sure that we're a welcoming city. We provide healthcare services to everyone that comes into our city, and making sure that we have someone who can interpret their healthcare needs with our staff so that they get the best available healthcare.
Absolutely. Thank you so much. And we are nearing the end. The next to the last is to accept and appropriate our annual grant from the Franklin County Alcohol, Drug Abuse, and Mental Health Board. It is a grant for our alcohol and drug abuse outpatient program. We are not an inpatient provider, as you know. Our 2017 grant is for a total of $1,616,117.65. Actually, the ordinance allows us, of course, to collect funds, as we are both asked and required to do, so it also allows us to have some client fees added to this fund, as well as a Medicaid reimbursement of $275,000. So the total appropriation being asked for consideration is $1,911,117.65. We have a variety of programs I know that you're familiar with in some ways, but we do provide outpatient treatment. We provide women's recovery services. We do provide support to the APPS project at the Columbus Recreation and park centers around mental health support. We are providing community prevention services. We provide after school services. So basically both on the treatment and the prevention side. And I won't read them all, but again, we are very both proud of the services. We are certainly not one of the largest ADAM providers, but we know that they are both appreciative of our services, and we're very appreciative of their support in doing this work. And again, I'd be happy to go into, I did share quite a bit of information about the different program areas. And again, we are very committed to culturally competent language competency. We also have a particular interest in our LGBTQ community. We are working specifically also with our Somali and our Hispanic communities. And of course, we have taken on more and more with respect to opiate abuse and addiction.
Thank you, Dr. Long. We are very appreciative of being able to have $1.9 million worth of services to provide to our community. Certainly, we know that alcohol, but most, and now the opiate and other addictions, drug addictions, are certainly a concern in our community. And we want to make sure that we have resources for individuals who have a new illness, as well as we certainly want to prevent individuals, especially our young people, from getting involved within drugs or alcohol. And this grant, 85% of it is for the alcohol and drug treatment program, and then $1 million or 100% of the $1 million is for the prevention program. So the $545,380 is for the treatment program. And just really do appreciate the work that your team is doing in regards to working with the individuals who now have a new illness, And so I thank you for that and providing these dollars in your outpatient program, your women's recovery program, certainly, again, working with the APPS program, working with recreation and parks to provide programs to our young people that come to the recreation centers and the after school programs. So this is great legislation, and I think that when we put it on the floor, I you know, for me, and I love these hearings, but I also think that some of the people who have benefited from these programs, it would be nice to hear from them, because I think that certainly when we're talking about it, people hear and listen, but I also think that people like to see people who have benefited from these programs, and maybe that would also encourage some other people to take advantage. So I thank you for the work that your team is doing and the outreach in our community. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And then the very last item is actually a simple one, but it needs to happen, and that is the assignment, or really it's a reassignment of a federal ID number for Jane C. Sutherland, who's doing business as Beaumont 4522 LLC. This is actually a long-standing relationship and contract that we've had with this entity. For a WIC location at 4950 Indianola, and it turns out that they have changed their federal ID numbers, and so we need to, of course, change it in our contract. So again, the contract is actually managed out of our facilities and management area, but this came because we can't pay them unless they have the federal ID number correct. So again, thanks to working with Director Lombardi and his team, this has all been figured out, and we just want to be sure that we're getting them the right federal ID number so we can pay them.
Thank you very much.
And thank you. I just want to say I appreciate the opportunity and the yielding of the kind gentleman in the front row, Mr. Lombardi, who usually gets to go first. And again, I'm going to slip out. I have a meeting up in a few minutes. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Long. All right, Director Lombardi, thank you for being so gracious and letting everyone go before you. And I know we have guests on your team tonight, so the floor is yours.
Thank you. And I want to thank Dr. Long for the kind comments. That $10 went very long way that I gave her. With your approval this evening, President Pro Tem Tyson, I would like to go out of order and to allow my invited partners to discuss the past successes and the future plans of the respective organizations that work to promote and strengthen the image of the City of Columbus. And as I give the background to Ordinance 0535-2017, I would invite Michael Brown, Vice President of Strategic Development from Experience Columbus, and his guests to come up to the podium. To increase tourism and convention business, and for the distribution of the hotel motel excise tax, which is in accordance to Section 371.02C of the Columbus City Code, which in part designates a portion of those funds for the purpose of promoting Columbus. This ordinance is to authorize the Finance and Management Director to contract with Experience Columbus for marketing services to increase tourism and convention business and to strengthen the image of the City of Columbus, and to authorize the expenditure of $9,776,000 from the Hotel Motel Excise Tax Fund and to declare an emergency. And I will turn over my time to Mr. Brown.
Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you, Council President Pro Tem Tyson, Director, to all the staff and team that are here tonight, and our guests with GCAC. Also, I've brought our newest ambassador.
Camille?
This is Camille's daughter, Maya.
Maya.
And this is Bruce Wimbush from our Sports Commission. And I don't think she's ever been to City Council before. But Bruce wanted to be here. Linda is in Dallas helping us win more business. She's actually checking in on the women's Final Four, which is there this year, and will be in Columbus, Ohio, obviously, next year. And Brian is out presenting J.D. Power at the airport tonight. So he was also on the road. Thank you guys very much for inviting us in to visit recently and bring the J.D. Power statue to City Hall as well. We are glad to share these honors with you as we all work together. Recently, you received a copy of our annual report with our budget submission for the year. Director, I believe you got one too. It has a lot of great highlights in it, but a few that we are talking about the most. We had a record-breaking year in the bed taxes, breaking $44.5 million. And just as we promised when we worked with Mr. Katzenmeyer at GCAC, the sports, the human services community, to talk about how we funded all of our programs, the promise was if we can change our models, and this was just 4 or 5 years ago, we believe that we could rake all the boats rise together. And if we worked harder and brought in more business, and that has certainly come true, more than a $10 million increase in the time since we've changed the model. And it's having a real impact now in our community. In addition, as you know, we are preparing for ASAE. As much excitement as we have about the Women's Final Four, ASAE is just as important to our community as we bring in about 5,000 of the country's biggest CEOs of associations and their event planners to show off our city for the first time ever. The economy is growing. We are now at about 75,000 jobs in this market employed in hospitality. And as I mentioned, the J.D. Power Award as the best visitor satisfaction in the Midwest in 2016. Our sales production in the past year was at 104% of our quota, which is multiple years in a row of growth. We also were ranked as the top 25 best website in the world for travel and tourism. So some real kudos to our team in marketing, in sales, and the services we provide to our visitors every year. Membership is at an all-time high. We're about to hit 1,100 members. And we are working very hard to make sure that those small businesses, many of them, but also the big businesses, all of our hotels and restaurants, all of our transportation companies, that they are all seeing the benefits and able to grow their businesses and add more jobs to this economy over time. Sports are really one of the most popular things that we do, so I'd like to give Bruce a few seconds to talk about what they're up to heading into the new year.
Council President Pro Tem Tyson, great to see you. Council, staff, director, thank you for this opportunity to be before you. Linda is in Dallas for the Women's Final Four. It is their last meeting of their local organizing committee, and they always invite host cities to come, and so we will do that for next year. But really excited for 2017 as we ramp up for the NCAA Women's Final Four, coming off the Women's Volleyball Championships last year. Our reputation with the NCAA is at an all-time high. And on April 18th, we will find out about 43 championship bids for 2019 through 2022. So we are really excited about what's coming in the spring. We unveiled the Women's Final Four logo last week at the Women's Sports Report to rave reviews. The NCAA had never unveiled that logo at an event, and they were very pleased with Columbus being the guinea pig and now the trendsetter. A few other events that we're really excited about are USA Track and Field having two events this year, one their annual meeting at the end of November, as well as the half marathon national championships within the Ohio Health Cap City for the second year in a row. And I think most importantly, the USA Boys Volleyball Junior National Championships in July will be the first sporting event booked that is in a completely renovated new convention center. So really excited. They were here in 2015, but they will feel like they're in a brand new building in just a few months. So thank you for your support, council, as well as your support personally.
With the great stuff that we've got coming to town and the great teams that are now working together in collaboration, I think honestly the Women's Final Four in volleyball and then coming in basketball, 6,000 or so coaches will be coming with the basketball tournament next year. A lot of people don't know that. It's not just the basketball, it's not just the championship game, but they also bring their coaches conference and other things to come enjoy our town for multiple days. But it's such a great time to be in Columbus, and the women leadership in this town right now is so important to helping us keep these great projects here. So thank you for your leadership on all the issues here. We work with the Y, we work with so many other great people in this town, but it's really starting to add up as we stack our hands and try to do more good here in the community. So thank you for the contract. We will put this to use and continue to build Columbus's name as a great hospitality city.
Thank you, Michael and Bruce, for coming down and certainly bringing Maya. She's a star here, too. Just really appreciate your work. One area that I'm very excited about, because we certainly are our income tax, but also to provide 75,000 jobs in our community. We certainly want to make sure that individuals in our community have access to good jobs within the hospitality field, and there are numerous jobs. And so I thank you for your leadership in terms of the commitment of thinking about Experience Columbus and the commitment to making sure that the hospitality industry is doing well. Also, thank you for Bruce for the Sports Commission. It's so important to bringing guests to our community and showing off our community. And so it's just been a really great partnership with Experience Columbus. I'm looking forward to the XB Awards, and you didn't mention that. I wanted to mention that the XB Awards are coming up from Experience Columbus, and just appreciate that you are showcasing the great things that are going on in the city of Columbus through that area. But again, I think it's been a good investment. So this $9,776,000 certainly is key to helping Experience Columbus and the Sports Commission to be able to grow and to prosper. As you mentioned, working with the GCAC and working with the Human Services, that certainly we understood the importance of, if guests are coming into our towns and staying in our hotels, that those dollars will then be able to support the arts community and the human service community. And certainly you have, we sat in my office a few years ago and you shared your plan. You certainly have been, you certainly have been hitting and exceeding the goals that you came in and told us that would happen should you be provided with extra dollars. And so I thank you both for coming down to council chambers this evening. Thank you, Maya, for being such just great for a young one lady, the young girl that has just been, in daddy's arms and, you know, just smiling and not just being well controlled in this environment. And so wonderful. And so again, thank you guys for coming down. I look forward to the pass to providing this legislation to my council colleagues and look to pass this legislation as soon as possible.
Thank you.
Council thank you
President,
so much.
Director, we brought new visitor guides that just came in this week.
Oh, great. Thank you.
And I would ask that and invite Mr. Tom Katzenmeier, the president and CEO of the Greater Columbus Arts Council, up to the podium. And while he makes his way up, I will talk briefly about our next ordinance. Again, in accordance with Section 371.02C of the Columbus City Code, which in part designates a portion of the hotel motel excise tax proceeds for the purpose of fostering arts and cultural services that enrich our community. Ordinance 0550-2017 authorizes the Director of Department of Finance and Management to enter into a contract with the Greater Columbus Arts Council, Inc., for the purpose of fostering and sustaining arts and cultural services that enrich the Columbus community, to authorize the expenditure of $6,667,000 from the Hotel Motel Excise Tax Fund and to declare an emergency. With that, I'll allow Mr. Katzmeier and I'm sorry, and Kayla Green to talk about their programs.
Thank you, Director Lombardi. It's great to be here this evening. I've got with me Kayla Green, who's Director of Finance and Administration for GCAC, and John Doherty's with us tonight too from the Film Commission. I know he's gonna be back in a couple weeks, I think, to speak. And before they leave, I want to thank Bruce. I think he already left, but Mike Brown is still here. These are, Priscilla, you know this, these are incredible partners of ours, and we are literally with them every day and working on things together, including things like the Women's Final Four and the ASAE event that's coming in 2019, and it couldn't be a better, stronger relationship. I also want to tell you that we value the longtime support of City Council for the Greater Columbus Arts Council. And I also want to particularly thank you for all your service on our board and everything you give us. So I thought I'd just do two things real quick. Talk about 2016, which is just past us, and give you a couple highlights that are coming for 2017. So 2016 was a great year in the arts in Central Ohio. I'll start with the Arts Festival. We had 450,000 people down on the river last June, 300 artists, 7 stages, 1,100 performers, 3,000 children going through the scavenger hunt, and beautiful weather. It was picture-perfect event last year. It was the 55th year, so we're coming up on the 56th one. Our marketing campaign, which you're familiar with, Columbus Makes Art, Art Makes Columbus, won an Emmy. This is the Emmy that we won. Here, hold it up over here. Yes. As you know, for about a year and a half, we've been running this marketing campaign. It is funded with city dollars and private support, so we have notable private support for this program. We hope to run it for 5 years or longer. It features 42 artists that we've featured, and 347 stories, and 20 PSAs, and it's actually the PSAs that we won the Emmy for. We had record-breaking attendance last October, at our annual Community Arts Partnership Awards, and a record amount of money raised at that event, so 650 people sold out. We had incredible partnerships in 16 with Experience Columbus, the Columbus Foundation, the Columbus Partnership, the CDDC, and WOSU. We had our first annual open stage and studio last October, which featured 26 artists' studios that you could go visit over the course of a weekend, and seven backstages that you could tour, 1,400 artist interactions, $25,000 worth of art sold all over one weekend, benefiting our artists here in Columbus. And then last but not least, the grants. With the money that we received from the bed tax, and as Mike mentioned, it was a record amount last year, $6.44 million. Of that amount, we put about $5 million back out into the community through our grant programs and through designated project support. So last year, that was 27 operating support grants, 57 project support grants, 170 artist grants, 29 artist exchange and fellowship grants, and several other smaller grants. Now for 17, we're gonna have another incredible arts festival. It's starts Friday, June 9th, runs for 3 days. If we have good weather, we'll have 500,000 people. We'll sell lots of beer. We have a lot of new features added this year. We're gonna have continue the marketing campaign. So we'll probably do another 20 or so public service announcements. We'll feature more artists with that campaign. The operating support process actually begins Monday. So Monday, March 6th is the deadline for that. We are expecting 28 organizations to apply for funds. The new one in that group that we're expecting this year is the Pizzuti Collection. So in past, we've funded them with project support. Now they're eligible to be in the operating support group. In July, we're going to release the Americans for the Arts latest economic impact study. So the current numbers are 8,500 jobs in the arts in Columbus and $226 million in spend. I'm expecting both of those numbers to go up, so we'll invite you to that event when we get it set. I think it's going to be July 24th. We'll do another open stage and studio weekend, October 7th and 8th, where we'll feature local artists. And I'm pleased to tell you, we have to move our annual luncheon to the convention center to accommodate the size of the crowd that it's grown to. So I want to thank you for all of this support. It's very, very meaningful to the artistic community, and the fact that we can make grants to 70 plus art organizations and fund more than 200 artists. So thank you very much. And I'd be happy to take any questions.
Tom, I really don't have any questions. But I will share that, as you mentioned, 8,500 jobs are in the arts in our community. And just as I mentioned with the number of jobs that are within the from Experience Columbus. And so it's really in the hospitality industry, et cetera. I mean, it is important that these dollars that are coming back into our community support jobs in our community, which is great. And certainly for me, I'm always talking about, I mean, in Columbus, we have to focus on, you know, safety, jobs, and neighborhoods. But certainly, every community has safety, jobs, and neighborhoods. cares about that. But the other part of our community is that we really are, it's important that we have a great quality of life. And quality of life is what makes a difference in communities. And certainly as we put the dollars, these bed tax dollars are supporting the Experience Columbus and supporting GCAC, that and human services, it really is about quality of life and quality of life in different ways. And so certainly just appreciate the work that GCA is doing. I'm excited about the Emmy that was received by GCAC, which really just highlights Columbus. And you've had a great arts festival last year, great arts festival coming up this year, but also I just want to make the connection too with the arts in terms of the school system, and that certainly that most of the large organizations that are supported by these grant dollars have relationships with the Columbus Public School System, that these children get to come there, experience the arts, either people from those arts organizations are going into the schools. And so Columbus, not only is it for the artists that are getting these dollars and those organizations, but how those dollars are also help our young people to be involved in the arts. And I think about the museum being open on Sundays, that's free for the community. So there's so many benefits for our overall community. And so just appreciate that, again, to our residents, these are bed tax dollars, and these are not the general fund dollars through sales tax. It's basically bought in because people are staying in our hotels. And that's why it's really important that GCAC is getting these dollars, because you also, these arts organizations are bringing in different exhibits to our city, and from people from all over the, sometimes not only Ohio, but of the country want to come view some of these exhibits, and they're staying. And so consequently, those dollars are then provided to you as well as to Experience Columbus and our social service agencies. So just appreciate what you're doing and your leadership as president. You have certainly taken GCAC to another level to provide our awesome culture in our community. So thank you.
Thank you very much. We appreciate your support. We also have a new annual that was just printed, so we'll leave them with you and one for Director Lombardi. But thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, our next, we'll go back in order now. So the first page, we have a resolution. It is 0048X2017 to recognize and celebrate March's Purchasing Month and to commend the public and private purchasing and supply management professionals for their commitment to excellence in their profession. Each March, we celebrate what we call March's Purchasing Month, and it really recognizes in the city our public procurement professionals who work hard every day to ensure that we are not only having the integrity of our public competitive process, but also to ensure that taxpayer dollars are being used wisely. Our public procurement professionals are not only in our purchasing office, which is run and oversaw by Sean Fouts, our procurement manager, but there are also others who are in the divisions as well who are trained by Sean and his staff. They belong to one of two groups. They belong to the National Institute of Governmental Purchasing, which is the national association that oversees all public procurement and has the promotion of that profession. And then we have a local chapter here as well called the Central Ohio Organization of Public Purchasers, which many of our staff are part of. And yours truly was the president of that organization at one time. And it does help to promote that profession and the hard work that they do each day to ensure that the integrity of the city's process and that the taxpayer dollars are being used wisely.
Thank you, Director, and certainly it was just appreciate you sharing. You were the president of the organization. I think that, again, adds just you know, credibility to you and your team, and that that you're part of an organization that certainly is looking out for what's in the best interest of our city residents, and thinking about how we're purchasing how we purchase items for the city of Columbus. So just appreciate your leadership on that, and appreciate your team that we work with each and every day to ensure that we are mindful and that we are having the dollars that we receive from our residents to be able to do the work of the city of Columbus, and that you are looking at it and purchasing in the best way possible to save us dollars and to provide the best products for our city. So thank you.
You're welcome. The next is ordinance 0381-2017, and this is to authorize the finance and management director to enter into one universal term contract for the option to purchase folding tables, chairs, and carts with Mighty Light, Inc., and to authorize the expenditure of $1 to establish the contract from the general fund. This contract is used primarily by the Recreation and Parks Department. It is to provide tables, chairs, and carts for setting up in the recreation centers for events, and for other agencies as well, for any events that they may need. The annual expenditure is $250,000 from this universal term contract.
Thank you.
The next ordinance is 0466-2017 to authorize and direct the Director of Finance and Management to establish purchase orders for the payment of annual membership dues for the City of Columbus with various organizations. Some of those and to authorize $115,000 from the general fund and to declare an emergency. The various agencies that the city maintains memberships include the National League of Cities, the Ohio Municipal League, U.S. Conference of Mayors, HANA News Service, Government Finance Officers Association, the Central Ohio Organization of Public Purchasers, and National Institute of Governmental Purchasing, just to name a few. As a member of these organizations, the staff really receives many benefits, including being able to go to seminars at discounted rates to network with their colleagues throughout the country to talk about similar issues and similar challenges that we all have in municipal government. So we believe that this is a very good ordinance that we are paying for the citywide memberships for many of our colleagues who belong to these organizations.
Thank you, Director, and I'm certainly in agreement with you on this. I had the opportunity to certainly be involved with the National League of Cities. I'm on the board of the National League of Cities and have held different leadership roles, but also I've certainly taken advantage of the programs that they offer that helps me to be a better council member, as well as it has been important for me to learn what other cities across the country are doing and to think about how that, you know, just to share what we've been doing as a city and also to learn what other cities are doing, and so to learn from those experiences. So it is well worthwhile to be involved, and I'm also involved in the Ohio Municipal League, and so I just personally have taken advantage of these memberships and very thankful that we have these memberships for our staff and colleagues. Thank you.
You're welcome. The next ordinance is 0551-2017, and this is to amend the 2016 capital improvement budget to authorize the city auditor to transfer funds within the Construction Management Capital Improvement Fund and to authorize the finance management director to modify a contract with Messer Construction Company for the 111 North Front Street building and parking deck project, to authorize the expenditure of $3 million from the Construction Management Capital Improvement Fund, and to declare an emergency. This is the project that is across the street, the new building and parking deck that is being built. During the initial studies and during the soil borings, nothing was coming up that would make us feel like we felt that there was something underground that may be an issue. However, during construction, during the excavation part of it, we uncovered an underground tank, better known as a gasometer tank, that was it's on the parking garage property. This underground tank, at one point, we think, might have held petroleum. The reason why it never came up in any of the studies or during the design or the soil boring, it looks like a big well. It's just this really big piece of tank. And so we had to remediate that. And we did not think that it would go beyond our contingency. However, it was bigger than we had anticipated once we got deeper into the ground. So we have had to add approximately $3 million to this project to when we remediated that. So this ordinance is asking council's approval for the modification to pay not only for that remediation, but so that we can continue on with the project without any interruption. This would bring the total of that contract to about $77.1 million with this modification, and we do not foresee any more issues with this project. As you see, it's coming along just well with the weather holding out. We are actually kind of moving faster than we thought. So this was just one of those items as we got deep into an old ground, we found it.
Thank you, Director, and certainly I saw a photo from 2015 that, you know, showed this tank, and I think when from the listening and viewing audience, when you see think about a tank, you think of something that's not as large as what this is. I mean, it basically went to almost the whole perimeter of the building. I mean, of the wall that was there. I mean, so I can kind of understand why it wasn't that when you did those borings that maybe that you did not when they did that they didn't realize that this tank was there, because a tank is almost was as large as the garage in terms of the length and the width of that thing.
That's correct. It was like another building underground. I mean, it was really the whole entire property. And so I think during the soil borings, there was nothing for it to hit. It was just going into the ground. And so there was nothing that came up that showed that this item was in there. And then when we began to dig, we found it on the perimeters. And then that's when we had recognized that it was larger than what we thought.
Okay, and these dollars, so tell me, with the $3 million, they're coming out of which fund?
These are coming out of our capital funds in the finance department and the construction management. These are monies that have already been either bonds that have been sold or cash that is on hand, so there's no additional bonds or cash that is needed. This is a money that we were able to find in maybe some older projects and moving it over. So. There's no additional bonds that need to be sold for this, and quite frankly, I believe most of it might be just from cash that we had on hand from projects that we have closed out, and we've canceled those dollars and moved them over.
Excellent. So most of it's cash. Is canceled some other ordinances that were that we had here.
That's
that we
correct.
No longer need those dollars for.
That so. Is correct, ma'am.
All right. All right, so thank you very much, and thank you again. I know we've been having a conversation about this issue for quite some time, and I do appreciate you, Deputy Director Dan Giangardella, showing me the photo of this, how large this tank happens to be.
It's quite impressive.
It is. Unbelievable. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your support.
You're welcome.
And our last ordinance this evening is 0553-2017, and this is to authorize the Finance and Management Director to enter into a universal term contract for the option to purchase trophies and awards with Village Trophy Company, to authorize the expenditure of $1 to establish the contract from the general fund. This ordinance allows the Department of Recreation and Parks, which is the primary user, to buy trophies and awards throughout the year for all their events and sporting leagues that they have with the children. Not to say that other departments can't use it for awards, but the primary user is Recreation and Parks. Now, the total amount of the annual expenditure is about $35,000 a year for this contract.
All right. Thank you, certainly, for the various City League awards and tournaments, and certainly, okay. Obviously, to provide an award for our children so that they continue to feel great about themselves when they've had a successful season.
That's correct.
All right. Thank you very much.
And that's all I have for this evening.
Thank you, Director. All right, well, this evening's hearing has provided insight into programs and community initiatives from Columbus Public Health, as well as the finance-related legislation that's necessary to support our ongoing city operations, and certainly the presentations from GCAC, as well as Experience Columbus, have been very helpful. Again, they do not receive the dollars out of our general fund, but they're receiving dollars from our bed tax. And so just appreciative of them coming down and showing the success of their organizations and how it relates to our community and the success of the quality of life for our residents. And in terms of quality of life also means being able to be employed, and certainly share that information tonight. So as residents, these hearings are an opportunity for you to learn and to become engaged in issues that are presented. And before I conclude tonight's hearing, I want to thank the City Treasurer's Office, Debbie Clee, our treasurer, from Columbus Public Health, Dr. Teresa Long, the Health Commissioner, from the Department of Finance and Management, Joe Lombardi, our Finance Director. City Council's Legislative Research Office, Michael Kessler, who leads the Legislative Research Office, who was in chambers this evening, Matt Erickson, who staffs Finance, the Finance Committee, Aaron Beck, who staffs Health and Human Services Committee, Nancy Sully from the Council's Community Engagement Division, and my staff, Nicole Harper and Carl Williams, and the hardworking team at CTV who make these hearings possible, and finally, the residents of the City of Columbus who make this city the best place to live, to work, and to raise a family. This hearing is adjourned. Thank you.